In our previous video clips, we have named a few rocks, such as basalt, granite, and peridotite. And we often throw around the terms rocks and minerals in everyday conversation. But what's the difference? First, what is a mineral? Well, five things need to be true for a substance to be labeled a mineral. A mineral must be naturally occurring, inorganic, which means no carbon-hydrogen bonds. This eliminates coal and other material made from plants. A mineral must be solid. And additionally, it must have a specific chemical composition. Think of it as having a very specific recipe. And lastly, it has to have an orderly internal structure. This is basically another way of saying it has to be crystalline. The atoms are arranged in a very specific manner. What minerals do you know? Consider the mineral table salt, which is called halite. It's naturally occurring, inorganic, and solid. Additionally, it has a very specific chemical composition, NaCl, and it has a crystalline structure. Halite crystals are cubic. In fact, if you let some salt water evaporate in a bucket on your driveway, you'll see the cubic halite crystals crystallizing out of the solution. How about oil? Is oil a mineral? No, it's liquid and organic. How about coal? No, that's organic as well. How about ice? Strange but true, ice is a mineral. Can you list some others? Your textbook table 13.1 shows some common rock-forming minerals, and it also notes the mineral groups. For example, the mineral halite was part of the group of halides. Gold, silver, copper, graphite, diamond are all native elements because they just contain one element. There's other mineral groups as well, but by far the most common mineral groups in the Earth's crust are the silicate minerals. This chart divides the silicate minerals into light silicates, which are light in color. They're also called non-ferromagnesium silicates because they don't contain iron and magnesium. And then we have the dark silicates, which are dark in color and contain iron and magnesium. Some of these names are probably familiar to you. Quartz, for example, is a very common mineral in the Earth's crust. Feldspar is the most common mineral in the Earth's crust. Perhaps some of these others you have heard of as well, like micas or olivines, amphibole, pyroxene. Again, these silicate minerals are the minerals that make up most of the rocks in the Earth's crust. Indeed, minerals in general, all the minerals here, are the building blocks for rocks. That's why we care about minerals. Rocks are made up of minerals. Thus, in order to learn how to identify rocks, most introductory geology students first learn to identify minerals. There's lots of good sites on the internet, both at the United States Geological Survey and then also just at some kind of recreational sites here where you can learn more about specific minerals. I encourage you to check some out. Minerals are pretty cool. Next, let's look at the definition of a rock. Rock is a lot more general term than mineral. Rocks can be defined simply as a consolidated mixture of minerals and or mineral-like substances. So it's just a solid mass of minerals stuck together. Or it might even include things that aren't minerals, like organic material. We've already mentioned a few specific rock names when we discussed the composition of the crust and the mantle. You should remember what rock the oceanic crust is made out of, for instance, and the rock that the continental crust is made out of, and the rock that the mantle is made out of. There are three different rock types: igneous, sedimentary, and metamorphic. What that means is that every rock on the planet can be lumped into one of these three groups, one of these three rock types. It's important that you be able to define these terms, which means essentially noting how each of these rock types is formed. And you'll also want to be able to give several specific examples of each type of rock, and the subtypes that we're going to mention soon. You need to get this material into your notes and review it until it's second nature. First, let's study igneous rocks. Igneous rocks form by the cooling and crystallization of magma. Look at the word igneous and note that it has the same prefix as the word ignite or ignition. So think of fire. Think of volcanic fire. Think of volcanoes and magma. These rocks, more or less, come from fire, from molten rock, from magma. So igneous rocks form as magma cools and crystallizes. There are two subtypes of igneous rocks: intrusive, or plutonic, and extrusive, or volcanic. If I asked you which one you thought formed deep within the Earth, and which one formed at or near the Earth's exterior, hopefully you could figure that out, right? Plutonic rocks form deep within the Earth, cooling slowly, and volcanic rocks form at or near the Earth's surface as lava comes out of volcanoes, and these rocks cool quickly. But again, both intrusive and extrusive rocks form as magma cools. Let's look at each subtype a bit closer. Intrusive igneous rocks form as magma cools slowly deep within the Earth. Since the magma is deep in the Earth, it's insulated from the cool surface temperatures, and thus it cools slowly. The slow rate of cooling allows the atoms in the magma to get where they need to go to form crystals. Thus, the crystals have a longer time to form and end up being quite large. Notably, by large crystals, we just mean we can see them easily with our naked eye, without magnification. So in all three of these examples here, granite, diorite, and gabbro, we can actually see different colors in the rock, in this case, different crystals in the rock. These are all intrusive igneous rocks. And again, some examples: granite, diorite, gabbro, and also a rock we've previously mentioned, peridotite. Here in California, we're fairly familiar with one particular intrusive igneous rock, with granite. Much of the Sierras, including Yosemite National Park, is made of granite. Most of the rock you see in this picture is likely granite or a very similar rock. Here's a picture, a close-up where you can see individual little crystals, and here's what you might see in a hand sample. Notably, and very importantly, these intrusive igneous rocks, or plutonic rocks, form deep, 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 miles deep in the Earth. We only see them at the surface today in places where there has been an enormous amount of erosion by wind, water, or glacial ice. So all of these rocks that make up the Sierra used to be deep in the Earth. Indeed, they formed deep in the Earth. We only see them today because erosion has taken away all the overlying material. So again, that's our intrusive igneous rocks, also called plutonic igneous rocks, for Pluto, the god of the underworld. Now let's take a look at our extrusive igneous rocks, our volcanic rocks, named for the Roman god of fire, Vulcan. Extrusive igneous rocks form as magma cools quickly at or near the Earth's surface, forming small crystals. Again, since the magma is at or near the surface, it cools quickly because it's exposed to the cool temperatures of the Earth's surface. That fast rate of cooling means there's not time to form large crystals. Thus, the crystals end up being small. And notably, by small, we mean we just can't see that the individual crystals without a hand lens or some sort of magnification. So all of these rocks, all these extrusive igneous rocks like rhyolite, andesite, and basalt were formed as lava came out of a volcano. So if you've been to somewhere with volcanoes, you've seen extrusive igneous rocks. Hawaii is a good example, as is parts of Idaho, which is what this picture shows. Shows a lot of flat-lying black rock, basalt, that was formed when there was massive outpourings of lava out of the earth millions of years ago. And again, basalt is a great example of an extrusive igneous rock. Has very, very small crystals, a kind of a black, dense rock. We don't really see the crystals unless we have magnification. Again, you'll also remember the basalt is what the ocean crust is made of. So how do we identify an igneous rock? Well, most igneous rocks, but not all, are crystalline. So one helpful hint for identifying a rock as igneous is to look for randomly oriented crystals. If a rock has randomly oriented crystals that are big, it likely cooled deep in the earth, and it's an intrusive igneous rock. If the crystals are small, it was likely formed by a volcano. Once you figure out a rock is igneous and to determine if it's intrusive or extrusive, then you consider the composition of the magma that formed it. In a very simple way, this can be reflected in the color of the rock. Igneous rocks that are mostly light silicate minerals have a felsic composition, very light colored and often pink. If there's more of the dark silicate minerals, or about half and half, the rock can be gray or black or kind of speckled like that. And if it's mostly dark silicate minerals, the rock's going to be much darker in color, and we say that it has a mafic composition. This table does a nice job of showing how different rocks are related. Stop the video after each of these questions and see if you can answer them. Which of the six rocks below formed from a volcano? Which of these six rocks formed deep within the earth, perhaps in the magma chamber beneath a volcano, or perhaps just deep in the earth? How are granite and gabbro similar? How are they different? How are diorite and andesite similar? How are they different? Hawaii is made up almost entirely of basalt from volcanic eruptions. Which rock likely exists deep beneath the island as the magma chambers holding that magma are cooling slowly? The Sierra Nevadas are made up of granite and a similar plutonic rock called granodiorite that's halfway between granite and diorite. These rocks form deep in the earth. Why are they at the earth's surface today? And if we consider that granite forms deep in the earth as magma chambers cool, what might once have existed where the Sierras are today? I'll answer this one for you. Volcanoes. The Sierras are the old magma chambers for ancient volcanoes. There were once volcanoes here, and they've long since died in terms of their activity, and they've eroded away. So at one time, there could have been volcanoes that were flowing out lava and perhaps creating rhyolite. All that has eroded away, and we're just left with the granite that represents the magma chambers that existed deep down below those ancient volcanoes. Here's one way of looking at it. In the next week or so, we're going to talk about volcanoes and other volcanic structures on the Earth's surface. But deep below all that, as the magma cools slowly, there's other intrusive or plutonic structures that are formed. And we'll talk about those structures as well. We only get to see these structures when all the overlying material is eroded away. Lastly, I encourage you to pause the video and answer these learning check questions for yourself.